thank you, chairpersons, for nice introduction, and also thank you organizing team as well as Dr. Anuj, who has given me this opportunity to speak about blood pressure and stroke. It's a very important topic from the point of life of the persons, morbidity of the persons, mortality of the persons. As we know, after our age, the death is MI, stroke, and the cancer, and you never know the trauma. So stroke and the hypertension is one of the leading cause to with heterogeneous pathomechanism and is primarily considered to be ischemic or hemorrhagic. Hypertension is one of the important risk factors for stroke, may lead to endothelial dysfunction, resulting in development of atherosclerosis. And small perforatus, who usually supplies the basal ganglia, in which we find out the dense hemiplegia, that altogether they are being supplied by the perforatus. They are also affected by the hypertension, and in hypertension, these small arteries rupture may lead to intracerebral hemorrhage or may cause occlusion and resulting in lacunar infarcts. And these lacunar infarcts may be the silent one, but may give rise to deterioration in the cognitive functions. Higher BP may be beneficial to the penumbra, ischemic penumbra, which is viable tissue, but underperfused. On the other hand, higher BP may increase the risk of hemorrhagic transformation. See that central area of the infarction or the hemorrhage is there and surrounded by the ischemic penumbra. And altogether, the BP management lies here to whether to reduce how much so that ischemic penumbra should be revived. And this is our treatment, main aim of the treatment. Many previous studies have investigated the optimal BP level and the effect of early rapid lowering of elevated BP. However, no ideal BP has been established. Management of blood pressure in ischemic stroke is complex, as multiple factors to be considered to determine BP target, including baseline BP, prior to treatment, reperfusion status, whether successful or not, hemorrhagic transformation after reperfusion treatment. Now, because as we advances, then the thrombolysis gradually coming up in so many areas, and also the awareness about stroke also there. So because the window is a 4.5 hours, so if the patient shifts and he also agrees, then good option is for the thrombolysis. And here the different criteria for the thrombolysis, that AHA and ASA guideline recommend that if AIS patients have a BP more than 185/110 and eligible for treatment with intravenous etiplase, their BP should be lowered carefully before intravenous etiplase treatment is initiated. Current guideline recommend maintaining blood pressure less than 180/105 during and after intravenous etiplase treatment for the first 24 hours after the treatment. Before and after intra-arterial endovascular treatment, that the mechanical thrombectomy. Current AHA-ASA guideline recommend that for patients who undergo endovascular treatment, BP during and or for 24 hours after treatment should be maintained at less than 180/105 millimeter mercury. In particular, if successful reperfusion is achieved, guideline recommend that blood pressure should be less than 180/105. Before and after intra-arterial endovascular treatment, recent multicenter study demonstrated that higher BP within first 24 hours after successful endovascular treatment was associated with higher risk of intracerebral hemorrhage and mortality. Moreover, the patients were divided into three groups, but the results remains that systolic blood pressure goal of less than 140 millimeter mercury was associated with better clinical outcome. Then systolic blood pressure less than 160 or less than 180. 140 is a better choice after endovascular treatment. Now, acute phase of about ischemic stroke, with the AHA and the ASA guideline, early treatment is indicated in patients with severe acute comorbidities such as acute coronary event, acute heart failure, aortic dissection, post-fibrinolysis, spontaneous intracerebral hemorrhage, hypertensive emergency or pre-eclampsia, eclampsia, and excessive decrease in BP can increase the risk of infarction growth. That means that if we rapidly decrease the blood pressure, then infarcted area may increase. Therefore, BP management should be individualized. Although there is no standard, it is generally considered safe and reasonable to lower BP by 15% from baseline in 24 hours. Acute phase, for patients who did not receive intravenous etiplase or endovascular treatment, and those without comorbid conditions, the recommendation differ based on the BP level. If BP is more than 220 by 120, the benefit of initiating treatment of hypertension within the first 48 to 72 hours is uncertain. However, it is generally considered reasonable to lower blood pressure by 15% during the first 24 hours after the stroke onset. If blood pressure is less than 220 by 120, initiating treatment of hypertension within the first 48 to 72 hours after attack is safe but not effective in preventing death or dependency. So more than 220, it's more better to reduce by the 15%. And if less than 220, the recent guideline says that you your choice is there and you may reduce 15% by the baseline in first 24 hours. The extracranial atherosclerosis, systolic blood pressure can be decreased up to 140 millimeter mercury, but risk of ischemic stroke is increased if systolic blood pressure is further lowered in both sides, more than 70% stenosis is there. Intracranial atherosclerosis, target BP is 120 by 240 millimeter mercury. A small vessel disease like perforators, BP to be maintained less than 130 by 80. Now in the hemorrhagic stroke, hemorrhagic strokes are categorized as either subacute, subarachnoid hemorrhage, intracerebral hemorrhage, with accounting for the 10 to 20% is of the intracerebral hemorrhage, and subarachnoid hemorrhage accounting for approximately 5%, so more amount of the intracerebral hemorrhage. Primary medical treatment for acute spontaneous intracerebral hemorrhage is BP management with goal of reducing hematoma expansion and perihematomal edema, improving functional outcome and reducing mortality as well as morbidity. In patients with subarachnoid hemorrhage, BP should be controlled to balance the risk of rebleeding while maintaining cerebral perfusion pressure. Elevated BP is very common in intracerebral hemorrhage, which may be due to premorbid hypertension or secondary increase due to raised ICP or stress. Elevated BP during active phase of intracerebral hemorrhage has been found to be associated with hematoma expansion, perihematomal edema, rebleeding, neurological deterioration, and death. However, there are certain concerns about decreasing BP too far, which may cause cerebral ischemia around the hematoma. Now, INTERACT 2 and ATTEST 2 trial, they say that systolic blood pressure should be 150 or 180 in the intracerebral hemorrhage, but we don't follow because subsequently American stroke guideline as well as American Heart Association guideline recommendations are there, and there are drawbacks in the INTERACT 2 trial. It was a large phase 3 clinical trial to address the effect of acute blood pressure lowering on intracerebral hemorrhage functional outcome. Randomized patient with spontaneous intracerebral hemorrhage within 6 hours of onset and a baseline systolic blood pressure to two different systolic BP targets less than 140 and 180. So we don't follow that. We follow with result of these trials, American Heart Association and American Stroke Association have provided guidelines which state that for patients with an systolic blood pressure between 150 and 220 millimeter mercury and without contraindication, the acute lowering of systolic blood pressure to 140 millimeter mercury is considered safe and may improve functional outcome in patient with intracerebral hemorrhage. Reducing systolic blood pressure less than 140 millimeter may increase the risk of adverse renal events. So they want to say that 150 to 220 millimeter mercury, if the blood pressure is there in a case of intracerebral hemorrhage, acutely you are seeing, reduce it out immediately to the 140 millimeter mercury if there is no comorbidities. Reducing further to 140 millimeter mercury may create the problem, and particularly in the renal area. Systolic blood pressure more than 220 millimeter mercury, aggressive reduction of systolic blood pressure may be reasonable with continuous intravenous infusion with frequent BP monitoring. A recent retrospective study has shown that when comparing target systolic blood pressure less than 160 millimeter mercury group and systolic blood pressure 140 millimeter mercury group, acute cerebral ischemia and neurological deterioration were more common in systolic blood pressure less than 140 millimeter mercury. In conclusion, in large randomized trial did not provide a consistent evidence that a specific target BP is beneficial. Therefore, individualization of BP target, risk and benefit in each patient may be needed. So here I would like to say that 140 millimeter mercury is a cutoff limit. So reduce it out. If there no comorbidities, nothing, then it's safe. Less than 140, if you reduce, it may create the problem. Target in subarachnoid hemorrhage. Rebleeding in patients with subarachnoid hemorrhage lead to an extremely poor prognosis. Although proper BP control is necessary to prevent rebleeding, the magnitude of BP control necessary to reduce the risk of rebleeding has not been established. For most patients with acute subarachnoid hemorrhage, the AHA, ASA recommends maintaining a systolic blood pressure less than 160 millimeter mercury to balance the risk of ischemia and rebleeding. The Neurocritical Care Society states that extreme hypertension in subarachnoid hemorrhage should be avoided and suggest maintaining a mean arterial pressure less than 110 millimeter mercury. When increased ICP is suspected, given the risk of impaired cerebral perfusion, increasing mean arterial pressure may be the only way to maintain cerebral perfusion pressure, because here the maintenance of the cerebral perfusion pressure is very much required to improve the ischemia and to avoid the infarction. Therefore, antihypertensive therapy is often withheld unless there is an extreme elevation in BP. A European guideline recommends MAP above 90 millimeter mercury to maintain proper cerebral perfusion pressure. In case of symptomatic cerebral vasospasm and delayed cerebral ischemia after subarachnoid hemorrhage, induced hypertension is recommended. Now, few drugs which can be used, because non-vasodilating agents like labetalol, nicardipine, and esmolol are preferred for the IV use. So in conclusion, the management of BP in stroke is complex and challenging due to the variety of stroke subtypes, heterogeneous etiologies, hemodynamic status, and comorbidities. BP management in AIS remains problematic, and questions such as when to start antihypertensive medication and how significantly to reduce BP have yet to be answered. The comorbidities, baseline BP, and stroke mechanism should be considered, and the time and target of lowering BP must be individualized when reperfusion is achieved through thrombolysis or thrombectomy, lowering BP reduces the risk of hemorrhagic complications. BP lowering in acute intracerebral hemorrhage is probably safe. However, if BP is lowered rapidly in the acute phase, adverse renal events may occur. In patients with intracerebral hemorrhage, systolic blood pressure between 150 to 220 without contraindication, acute lowering of systolic blood pressure to 140 millimeter mercury is safe. Reducing below 140 the first hours after onset may increase the risk of renal adverse events. For patients with systolic blood pressure more than 220, aggressively reduce. Control of BP variability may be useful. For prevention of recurrent stroke, BP management for target BP less than 130 by 80 millimeter mercury is recommended when the patient is medically and neurologically safe. For intravenous thrombolysis, before IV TPA less than 185 by 110, during and for 24 hours after TPA less than 185 by 105 millimeter mercury. Regarding for the thrombectomy, during and for 24 hours after endovascular treatment, less than 185 by 105 millimeter mercury. If failed reperfusion, then maintain blood pressure at more than 150. If successful reperfusion, maintain blood pressure less than 140. If hemorrhagic transformation is there, maintain blood pressure at 140 millimeter mercury. In acute phase, in the ischemic stroke, more than 220 by 120, generally lower BP by 15% in first 24 hours. Lowering BP has uncertain benefit within 48 to 72 hours. If BP is less than 220 by 110, initiating hypertensive is safe but not effective to prevent death or dependency. But if hypertension is present with severe acute comorbidities, I'll lower BP by 15% from baseline in first 24 hours. Patient's systolic blood pressure more than 140 by 90 and neurologically stable, start antihypertensive during hospitalization. Thanks for your attention.